All right, Retro Radio up next. We appreciate you guys tuning in for the Sports Report. We'll be back next week with one final round of the Sports Report before our football season begins here at JCU. Blue Streaks Radio Network, of course. Football season begins on September 1st, so get ready for that. We'll talk to you guys then. Same time, same place.
This is WGCU, University Heights.
Hey, Aretha. Paying homage to the Queen.
That's right.
Queen.
Song.
You're on camera, Dave. Show us the CD.
Yo, track two.
Track two.
We'll talk right after this.
Yeah.
You'll introduce me.
I will do that.
And when
here we go.
Tribute to the Queen of Soul, Aretha Franklin and Soulville from 1964, 302 in the Rock and Roll City. I'm Jumpin' Joe Madigan, and joining me today on Retro Radio is Dave Atkins.
Hello, Joe. Soulville bubbled under the pop charts. It was her fourth bubble under, and it was on Columbia. It entered the bubble under charts May 9th of 64. It went to number 121, and it was 4 weeks bubbling under.
How can that be? That's such a killer record.
Well, I'll tell you, she really started hitting the high numbers when she went to Atlantic, but she had plenty of great stuff on Columbia, so we will be celebrating Aretha throughout the whole show off and on if we're able to pull it off the internet. And we got Ray King in here. Happy birthday, Ray King.
Sir. Happy birthday, Ray.
Woo-hee!
Video today. He sure is.
These two vinyl guys.
Well, this is a very important day in the history of rock and roll. Sometimes some of the greatest albums didn't even hit the Billboard charts. And this is one of the great albums. It came out on this day in 1970. The band's first album charted. The band's third album charted. But this one in 1970, it did not chart. And this, we have finally found out, is the song that the band itself wanted to start the album. However, the record company decided that another song should start the album that they were going to put on a single. Ladies and gentlemen, happy birthday to Funhouse by the Stooges. I give you Loose. All right, the Stooges. The birthday of the drummer was just 2 days ago. I want to thank My Mind's Eye for giving me that information. Born in 1949, rock action, Scott Ashton, one of the great drummers of rock. He appeared on that song, Loose. He was the drummer with the Stooges from the inception. And we opened for Oasis, the Witch Hunters, New Salem Witch Hunters, in 1996. And during the sound check, Oasis at the Lakewood High School, Noel Gallagher was blasting away on the Stooges' I Want to Be Your Dog. And I was floored by this. And the only time I ever spoke to Noel Gallagher of Oasis, I said, wow, you knew I Want to Be Your Dog. And he was talking about the first album. Ah, it's top. It's top. That was his word. He thought the first album was the thing. So Noel Gallagher, interestingly enough, it must have been in 73. Very interesting charting in 1973 because the Beatles and Paul McCartney and George Harrison were fighting for supremacy in 1973 for the album charts. In the Billboard album charts, the Beatles, 67 to 70, it entered and it was actually at number one May 26th of 73 for 1 week. Then Paul McCartney's Red Road Speedway knocked the Beatles out on June 2nd of 73. That was number one. And then finally, George Harrison's Living in the Material World knocked Paul McCartney's album out. A whopping 5 weeks, Living in the Material World was number one. June 23rd of 73 to July 21st of 73. So Noel Gallagher, we're going to listen to what he has to say about a song that he heard. I believe it was the red double record set was the earlier Beatles stuff, and the blue was the later stuff, right? Both of them charted in the United States, and Noel Gallagher got this, and he's going to talk now for 18 seconds about what exactly he thought was so astounding about this one particular single.
Ticket to Ride, I think, is one of the greatest, if not the greatest, pop song, sort of 2.5, 3 minute pop song ever written. And it's a song that personally I've been trying to rip off for about 7.5 years now. So there it is, Ticket to Ride. That's my favourite Beatles track of all time.
our buddy Jim Jones was in Pure Ubu. And
oh, you play the stereo version.
Well, this is a special mix that our buddy Jim Jones did.
Oh, you'll have to say that.
Yeah.
Because they know I'm a mono power guy.
You think?
The Beatles in super separated stereo and taking a ride. Oh my goodness, Dave, what's that all about?
That's my buddy. He was in the Easter Monkeys and Pure Ubu, and I said, Jim Jones, I need you to make me a copy on CD of the Beatles' Help U.S. album. He took forever. He worked on this thing. He says on here, 11/03 to January 04, all tracks painstakingly reproduced for optimum sonic enjoyment by Jim Jones. So Jones was one of the greatest guys you'd ever want to meet, and the Easter Monkeys was one of the great bands of the 80s here in Cleveland. And, of course, everybody knows about some of his work in Pure Ubu, possibly. But that's the reason we played that. And also because this day, 1962, the calendar's the same. Ringo Starr officially became a member of the Beatles and drummed with them as a full-fledged member of the Beatles on this day. It was a Saturday. The calendar's the same. So we're going to be having Beatles throughout this whole show. And I want to dedicate this next single to Ray King. Without Ray King, there wouldn't be a retro radio because Jumpin' Joe had his own life to live. But he also is able to do his radio show thanks to Ray King.
My pleasure,
so it's his birthday today, and Ray, I want to tip the hat to you. And if you're unfamiliar with the B-side, this is the same band, and this is the day this entered the charts on this day, Saturday, August 18th, 1962. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Rivingtons. Yeah, that was the B-side to Papa Umau Mau. That was a real surprise. Deep Water. That goes out to Ray King. Without Ray King, there would be no retro radio. Well, one of the greatest exploitation albums ever made was on a Capitol subsidiary called Sidewalk. From 1967, I give you the title track, Freak Out, USA.
Starting on the sunset. If I can.
Hey, hold on.
There. We're doing track four, Joe.
Track four, okay.
Yeah.
So, Ray, come over here. Here.
Here?
Shoot the board.
Okay.
You put it in preview. Preview is turntable one. You come over here. Now you gotta be careful because sometimes the needle protector's on. This one is off. So you gotta turn the turntable on. And it's cut four. So one, two, three, four. Bring it down. In preview here. It's the end of the third cut. So you wait until the beginning of the fourth cut starts. Oh, I think it's already beginning. Oh, it kind of fades into the cut. That makes it harder. A quarter turn back. And because it segs into the song, I'm gonna have to fade it in.
Okay.
Now this is auto start, just like the CD player. So once you hit the on button and fade it up, it'll be going.
Okay.
But normally, well, even with the turntable, I would turn it on and fade it up fast, just in case.
Right.
It misfires. Pretty easy, right?
Yep.
All right, 30 seconds.
Thank you.
And then you'll see it start to spin here. All right, 10 seconds.
Freak Out USA from 67. July 31st of 1967, the Byrds began working on Notorious Byrd Brothers. They were having trouble with Dave Crosby. He'd said some stuff during Monterey, and then things weren't going right for the band. But they did record something on July 31st of 67 that would later appear on the Notorious Byrd Brothers that was released January 3rd of 68. This song is called Draft Morning, and the sound effects that you hear, the war sounds, are made by the Firesign Theater. So here's a mono promo on Columbia. Nick Amster remembers this came in the first batch that arrived in 1968. He was up in New York City at the time. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you the Birds and Draft Morning.
The Birds on Retro Radio on 88.7 WJCU and worldwide at WJCU.org. 326, I'm Jumpin' Joe Madigan. Dave Atkins joins me in the studio today, featuring a lot of things that have happened on this day in music history and a lot of stuff that bubbled under. That means it did not hit the Billboard Top 100.
And here's something that had no chance whatsoever of hitting anything because it never came out until this year. It was recorded in 67, we think. And thanks to Matt Baker, he gets a lot of this old tapes, and he's able to put the stuff out. And some of the original band members actually get money for some of this stuff. Could have been recorded possibly in February 68, but more likely 1967. And this has just been reissued. I give you The Royal Chessmen and Don't Tread on Me.
45 time.
Yeah, it's Bob Dylan's Pledging My Time. Now you gotta make sure that you're on 45 RPMs, or you're gonna do what I did and play a Canned Heat at 33 and a third.
I think I remember that.
Yep. This is, going up the country sounds like a nice blues record at 33 and a third. All right. Yeah, it needs more weight. And then back a corner turn.
Okay.
And then I'm gonna start it right now.
Edit.
Not really.
They chop off verse 2 and verse 5 and it fades out. It was recorded Columbia Music Row Studios February 14th, 17th, March 8th, 9th, 66 possibly. It's the flip side of Rainy Day Women, and that one has verses 3 and 5 chopped off of it. So both are two verses shorter. This Dylan single might have been March or April of 66. And before that, we heard Don't Tread on Me by the Royal Chessmen. Beautiful 60s sounds on a brand new 45. The record had never been released before on BW Records. Good music is good business. You know, when I think of Dylan, I think of our buddy Nick. And Nick wants to tell you a little bit of something with a song that Keith Richards wrote. So here we go.
This is Nick? Nick Amster?
Yes.
Is it really? Really?
Yeah.
This is Nick Amster? Wow. When was this? That was this? When was this?
Just listen. That's fabulous.
Oh my God, another minute and 57 of this. Dave, you're killing me.
Tiny Tim, for real? What's this called?
I didn't put anything in this frosty root beer today to get me through
girl.
This.
That's girl.
Girl, huh?
Yeah. Look at that mono where you see more at the bottom. This is a super rarity in mono.
Oh, yeah, the Beatles song. Right.
Yeah. Mono. Yardbirds.
Wait a minute.
With special extra bottom.
Nice.
Very, very rare.
When was this recorded? Assembled.
In China.
First song on this one, Joe. Shouldn't be any problem.
Give him the hook! brutal.
Ray King wants to send that out to Tim and Minner on the lake. And I want to send it out to Swanson. I want to thank Bobby Horstemeyer. That's from Uncut, Why Don't We Do It in the Road. Tiny Tim with Brave Combo.
Tiny Tim!
From 1996, yeah. Oh. And before that, we had the Beatles, all four of them talking. That's a little intro.
And
even before that, okay, go ahead.
There's something you have to realize. There is a barber shop in Chagrin Falls, Ohio.
Yep.
They turn on retro radio each and every week.
Yep.
There is probably somebody getting a free haircut
a
right
mohawk.
Now.
A mohawk.
Because Dutch just probably shaved their head off by accident when they heard Tiny Tim start singing that. Good grief, Charlie Brown.
Just celebrating Ringo joining the Beatles. That's all. On this day in 62,
oh,
I just remember.
That's
I turned 16
be a better
that
way,
day.
Dave.
Before that, we had Nick Amster and the Godniks doing Connection.
That was cool. I dug it. And
everybody digs it.
Yeah, it's Nick Amster. I mean, come on, man. He's the kind of guy, if you ever see him, and believe me, you know him when you see him, you just go up to him and you talk to him about anything from the year 1967, and he will be your new best friend.
That's his album, Know How. It's part of a trinity he's creating. I consider it a three-sided album, and he calls it Know How, but I think a better name for this album would be A Werewolf. Ladies and gentlemen, we're going to go now to March 9th of 68. This entered the country charts. On April 20th of 68, 50 years ago, it went to number one. I give you Loretta Lynn.
Oh, blackmail. That's what this is going to be.
I missed the good part.
My impersonation of 1996 Tiny Tim singing Girl. Girl. Oh, girl. Oh. You like that, Dave?
Wow.
You like that, friend?
Beautiful. What a great
cut.
What a great birthday.
Stand by.
Loretta Lynn in Fifth City went to number one in 68 on the country chart. Well, August 12th of 67, this is a mono album. Took me forever to find a mono one. The Yardbirds. It went to number 80 in the Billboard charts, and the album was 8 weeks. From the Little Games album, I give you the title track, Little Games.
Going backwards.
Yeah,
we can do it. Put on the Beatles again.
Oh, the super separated stereo mix.
Who knows?
Ray King kind of music.
Who knows? What a great song. We found out Fallon has the best setup for singles and albums of the 60s and 70s.
Oh, yeah.
You have entered a different dimension in the center of your mind because you are listening to Dave Atkins and Jumpin' Joe Madigan on Retro Radio on 88.7 WJCU and worldwide at WJCU.org. Yardbirds and Little Games, the first cut on the first side of their album with the same name from 1967.
Ladies and gentlemen, we all know that the Reverend Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was tragically killed in 1968, and it was that weekend, on the Friday and the Saturday, that The Who played the Fillmore East. For many years, a bootleg has been around, and I've recently found out that it was an acetate made by, I believe, Kit Lambert of Live Recordings. The first side was the second night, and the second side of this bootleg was the first night. For years, I always thought the song was called Easy Going Guy, and it always had a skip in it. Finally, there's a 2-CD set out of the second night called The Who Live at the Fillmore East. And here we can finally hear the song. It's called My Way. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you The Who Live, 1968.
City, but not a community.
Ladies and gentlemen, RFK, Robert F. Kennedy, speaking in Cleveland, Ohio. He didn't do any political stuff that day. He just talked to Clevelanders the day after Martin Luther King Jr. was tragically assassinated. At the same time, The Who was preparing to do their first show at the Fillmore East in 1968. One of the great speeches of Robert Kennedy's life. And now, we had a request. And who requested this next song?
That is Rob in Buffalo, New York, listening online at WJCU.org. Did you ever think that someday you could walk into a studio and your voice would be heard not only throughout the Cleveland airwaves, but across state lines? Not over the air, but also through this magical device called the Internet, which is hard to fathom at times. But it's amazing how people from all over the world, even all the way down in Australia, can listen to this program because of the Internet. So there you have it. I got really deep there. I didn't mean to. But it's Robin Buffalo, New York, all right? You don't want to hear the deep thoughts of Jim
and before you complain about it, this is another Jim Jones special mix. So here we go. You're going to lose that girl.
I'm not pregnant. I'm on the root beer diet.
Yeah, I remember that one. I like the milkshake diet better.
Yeah. I dig this. Lou Rolls. There you go. Everybody look what's going down.
I think it's time we stop children. What's that sound? Everybody look what's going down. I dig it, man. That's Lou Rawls doing the Buffalo Springfields for What It's Worth. And it's on side one, cut three of his album Feeling Good, and he got that at Jerry's.
Yeah, yeah, that's a scarce album of his. It entered the pop charts May 9th of 68, went to number 103, was 22 weeks in the charts. So, I mean,
wow.
It went to number 103, yet it was 22 weeks in the charts. That's pretty remarkable.
Yeah, that's incredible.
Well, an album that didn't chart in America is one of the greatest albums of all time.
Indeed, yes.
The Kinks are the Village Green Preservation Society. Was it released in January of 69 in America? I don't know. Nick Amster said he ordered the thing so he could get it through the mail from England, I guess. But maybe I'm wrong about that. But this is one of my favorites. And this was not on the original sequence of songs that Ray had put out at first. There's a New Zealand version of this album that's very rare that doesn't have as many songs, and some songs were yanked. But then he added a few more songs, and this is one of them, and it's called Big Sky.
Quick.
Which one?
Put it in. Track 9.
Track 9?
Yeah.
One of my favorite cuts from the Village Green album, that's Big Sky.
The word is there may be a 5-CD set of that thing coming out. I mean, I thought it was amazing with 3 CDs. So that really is quite an album. For an album that didn't sell, I maybe it charted in England. I don't know. It might have been one of those albums that just didn't chart. But, you know, Bobby Kennedy was gunned down. And Chad and Jeremy put out an incredible album at the end of August of 68 called The Ark. Chad Stewart and Jeremy Clyde, Peter and Gordon, Chad and Jeremy. Well, Chad Stewart, I guess, doesn't want to tour anymore, so Jeremy has teamed up with Peter Asher, and now it's Peter and Jeremy. They're actually out there doing stuff, right, Ray? Yeah. And we want to hear a song they did about the death. See, Bobby Kennedy was killed after midnight, about 12:15 a.m. He was shot, and then he lingered for a whole day. And people even made bumper stickers that they wore on their clothing that said, "Pray for Bobby." I was 8 years old at the time, and I made a scrapbook about this. It was an incredibly tragic time, and I gave it to my friend Tim Moses, and his dad was in the FBI back then. And he later gave me 2 wanted posters, and one was a Eldridge Cleaver wanted poster. Because I thought, oh, the FBI guy, he needs this because it's a crime scrapbook. But I remember the train as it passed and all the people standing and watching. And Chad and Jeremy, this is a song me and Jeff try to play every summer. And so this goes out to Jeff, Sidewalk Requiem, Los Angeles, June 5th and 6th. He lasted a full day, and then when it turned to the next day, then he passed on. So this goes out to Bobby Kennedy from Chad and Jeremy.
Boris the Spider. Strange you mentioned that record. Because the song right before it, we're going to do a Who twofer after we play The Quick. Or we're going to play the Quick, the Beatles, and then a Who twofer.
All right.
Okay. Sounds good. Thanks. Okay, talk to you later. Bye.
Bye-bye. There you go. A rare appearance by Dave Atkins' sister. That's amazing.
This is super rare.
The Red Album.
It's the Quick One, the British version in mono with the super hot Run, Run, Run mix.
Ooh.
Fallon got it August 16th. He touched his record August 16th of this year. The day I found this in my bedroom.
Wow.
I've had it for years and didn't even know I had it. Didn't know I had the hot mix. I can't believe my sister requested that. Radio moment, Joe.
Joe, what can you tell us about that song? It sure did sound like Steve Marriott.
No, that was a group from Cleveland, Ohio called The Quick. Now, that name may not be familiar to you, but you are familiar with the man singing. That is the one, the only, Eric Carmen. And yes, he was heavily influenced by the Small Faces and Steve Marriott, and he could do him justice. He really could.
Steve Marriott was one of the greatest rock vocalists ever, and for Eric Carmen to be able to sing like that just is a testament to the greatness of Eric Carmen himself. I'll remember the time that we were at that concert and I introduced you to Eric Carmen. I didn't know the guy, but I just happened to see him there, and I said, Joe, here's Eric Carmen.
I remember that. I didn't know what was going on. I remember it exactly. It was the Beachland Ballroom 6th anniversary show, and that was very memorable because it reunited the choir for the first time in 40 years, and introducing, or the opening acts for the choir were the S-Shades from Ashland, Ohio, and the Alarm Clocks, and that's how my relationship with the Alarm Clocks started, and that was in 2000, that was March, the first weekend of March of 2006, and it was the second show, because they did two shows, a Friday and a Saturday. It was the Saturday show. I'm standing in the back listening, and you come up to me and say, Joe, come here. And we rush out the back door, and there's Eric Carmen standing there. He's talking to three girls who are acting like they're teenagers all over again. And next thing I know, I'm talking to Eric Carmen. I tell him that one of the great records from him that I like to play on the show, it was from his days with Cyrus Erie, Get the Message. And he just rolled his eyes and he kind of laughed. He goes, I can't believe anybody's actually playing that record. I interviewed him about 10 years later, only to discover he was unhappy with that whole recording session because of the producer, and he didn't get along with them. But then they remixed it a couple years later when Sony issued the Essential Eric Carmen collection. They remixed it, and it's a much better mix. He's very happy with it. So I play that one from time to time. So, yeah, that was my first meeting with Eric Carmen.
Well, we love that epic single of Get the Message. That night, Bill Schwark was the drummer for the Alarm Clocks, and he was later in Damnation of Adam Blessing, and we were talking to him about the Cincinnati Pop Festival, very interested in that because so many great people played there, and they had that TV show that got a review in, I think, the Cleveland Press or the Plain Dealer on my birthday, Friday, November 13th of 1970. But the Stooges were there, of course. That's where they hand Iggy the peanut butter. Some say it was Stiv Bader's. But I asked Bill Schwark about it, the drummer for the Alarm Clocks, and he said Damnation of Adam Blessing was the first band to play. So they got to see everybody that day. And their favorite was Grand Funk Railroad. So that was just a thrill talking to all those people. Well, let's get back onto the Beatle track. This was recorded at Trident Studios, so not much apparently is known about how this was actually recorded. There might not be any John Lennon on it, but this is a mono version from a recreation of the original British mono, and it's a killer George called Savoy Truffle.